Hello everyone. If you are learning a foreign language or if you are planning to learn a foreign language, then this video is going to be very helpful for you. Because today we have with us a special guest and a very dear friend of mine, Mr. Sunil, who is currently working as a French language translator and an interpreter in a multinational company Capgemini in Mumbai. In this video, he is going to share a lot of invaluable insights and knowledge about career in foreign languages. So watch the whole video till the end. If you are willing to learn French, then our A1 basic French course is going to start from 25th of October. You can enroll in this course. The link is given in the description. So enroll yourself right now before the registration is closed.
Yeah, so hello Sunil, I welcome you on my channel Language Pathways. So thank you so much for being with us today. And it's an honor for me, you know, having you on this channel today.
Well, hi Ankit. In fact, it's an honor for me to see you back again after a very long time. Thank you.
Yeah, my pleasure. So let's start today's session with the introduction. So Sunil, could you please introduce yourself to our viewers, like what you are doing currently?
Sure, with pleasure. In fact, yes, my name is Sunil Diwate, and I'm actually basically a French translator and interpreter. And I'm also a language teacher. I teach English and French both to Indians. And I have been working in the language fields in the last 15 years. So I started the first 5 years of my career, I was working as a customer care executive. And after that, I started working as a language translator and interpreter. That was, when I got into the IT sector. And well, obviously, I'm still working as a translator and interpreter here, again in the IT sector, and I'm also continuing teaching English and French to my fellow Indians.
So currently, you are a language translator. You are a French language translator in Capgemini Mumbai, right?
That's right. Yes.
Great. So, and what are your roles and responsibilities in that company?
I have the roles and responsibilities that a normal French translator has. So we actually have, when we say translation, you know, there are two kinds of translation. You have the you have document translation and you have oral translation. So we have to do both. Now we translate documents, be it Excel, be it Word, be it PowerPoint, and others. And besides that, we also are like intermediaries, you know, for the French people and the Indian people. So we have the Indian technicians working for this company. And on the other hand, we have obviously the French people who need the translation services. So we have to participate in calls. We have to attend meetings. And we even have what we call face-to-face translation, which is, again, I know, a simultaneous translation. And besides that, we also now there's a new kind of translation, which happens while chatting. So that is also something that we do. So we chat with our end users, our end customers, and obviously, you know, we fill this gap between the Indian counterparts and the French ones.
Okay, that's great. And since how long you have been working in Capgemini?
Well, it's been 5 years I've been working here, always as a language specialist. And recently I've also started working as a KM, which means, you know, I manage knowledge bases for my project, for the team that I work for.
Okay, that's great. And Sunil, I would also like to know that what was your first job? What were your roles and responsibilities in that job as well?
Yes, in fact, as a fresher, I started working for the Indian brand called ICICI, and I was actually a part of the back office team. So Now, my role there was, in fact, to interact with, you know, to interact with people who are based out of Europe, people who are, who live there in Europe. And what happened there, I was in the collection agency, so I used to contact people in Europe. I used to get them to pay their dues and all. And, you know, that's where I started, I mean, that was something that made me think, why not begin my career in the language field? Because I was already learning French there, and I could speak French already. And since I was a French, I mean, I speak French, well, my colleagues, they used to transfer me calls of people who, you know, who could not speak English and who were from countries like Switzerland, France, Belgium, and all, you know, the other French-speaking countries, and who had this, who had difficulties communicating in English. And so, you know, I started taking more and more calls, in French. And in the end of the day, I thought, okay, I mean, if that's what I'm supposed to do, why not start working in the language field in a full-fledged way? And that's when I started looking for opportunities elsewhere.
Okay, apart like after your first job, what other jobs you did?
After ICICI, I started working. I mean, after ICICI, I actually got into the IT field. I started working for WNS, and I started working as a French agent there. So I was working for an airline company as a French agent. So our responsibility there was to manage the facilities given to the Air Canada employees, to the airline employees. So we were like, we were kind of the HR, you know, HR department, and we used to manage all their facilities. We used to answer their queries and guide them how to use their facilities and other stuff. So okay, that was it. Yep. Again, that was related to French. Yep.
It was your second job?
Yeah, that was my second job. Yeah.
And apart from that, any other job you did?
Well, look, ever since I was in college, you know, ever since I started learning French, I have been teaching French and English to school and college people. So that was one thing, you know, that's something that I've always been doing in parallel. So after my first job, which was in ICICI, I started working full-fledgedly as a French agent in WNS, you know, in the airline sector. And well, that's where I worked for, I think, 3 years, yes. And later on, I started working as a translator, because until now, I was actually a French agent, which means I know basically my job was to handle calls and talk over the phone with the French speaking people.
Okay, you also worked in Minister of with like your, you know, an External Affairs Ministry, right, as a French interpreter.
Yes, that's right. You know, after my second job, where I worked for 3 years, well, I got a very good opportunity to work with foreign governments. Now, this is a company based in Delhi, and we're sort of B2G. Now, we used to work for, you know, we used to work for foreign governments. We used to help these. That was more like a, you know, that was within the framework of bilateral and multilateral relationship between India and other countries. So we used to, in fact, help other countries build infrastructure like airports, you know, the electric towers and all those stuff. Now, that's where I had the opportunity to work with foreign delegations. Now, the foreign delegations that used to come here in India, I used to always be with them as a language interpreter. So now, obviously, when I say foreign delegations, these are actually delegations coming from the French-speaking world. So they can be, you know, from North Africa, from the Arab world, you know, or from other countries. So yes, that was indeed a very good opportunity, I'd say.
Okay, that's great. Okay, now we would like to know about the interview. Okay, like if someone is going for the job interview, okay, if someone is going for the job interview, so what are the rounds? What are the interview rounds are there, and what questions which are generally asked in those rounds?
Yep. Now, I'll tell you what, you know, when it comes to rounds, obviously the first round, Now, basically what happens in our industry, I'll tell you that in fact, the first round that you have is a telephonic round. That's where we try to judge people, you know, on the language skills. Now, I've been taking interviews. I have taken more than 200 to 300 interviews of French speakers in India. So what we do is we first try to know how good the candidate can speak in French, so that, you know, that happens in over the phone. And then we have something that we call face to face round. That's where we call the candidate and see face to face. How good they are in how fluent they are in languages, both English and French. Because obviously, when you speak when you talk of a translator has to be good in both the languages, you know, the Swiss language and the target language. So that's what our aim is. And then the third round is actually the round where we judge their writing skills. So that's where we give them some paragraphs, or we give them sentences to translate in both languages. And after that, we have some mock tests, which we'll try to pretend to be someone who doesn't know the target language, and ask that person to translate what we have said, and vice versa. That's the third round. And then, obviously, we have the operations round. Now, the operations round is where it's a project manager, you know, or the project head, who will try to judge if you're fit for that job or not. Now, not linguistically, not just linguistically, but also, you know, in other ways. He'll try to see how good, how motivated you are. What's your team spirit level and other stuff, you know, your personality and everything. And then obviously you have the HR round, you know, that's where you negotiate the salary, and you know, that's something that, you know, confirms that you're selected, and you might start working for the company very well, obviously, you know, as long as you accept their package, and or, you know, they are okay with your requirements or your demand.
Okay, and what are the questions which are generally asked in these rounds?
Yeah, look, at least for me, you know, when it comes to telephonic round or face-to-face round, the rounds where we actually try to, I don't know, we try to judge the linguistic skills, the questions can be anything. We just want the candidates to speak. You know, we want to see whether they're making any grammatical mistakes or not. We want to see, you know, how confidently they speak, because especially when it comes to face-to-face translation, like I used to be there with the ministers, you know, that's where you have to be, you know, you have to sound very confident, and you have to be very fluent, because obviously, you know, you're actually with the high level ministers, and obviously you would not want your image to be tarnished. So we want the best candidates in the industry. So the questions can be like something like, you know, okay, starting from something like, okay, tell me about yourself, your family background, and we would want them to speak to us at least for, say, 4 to 5 minutes, and then we can ask them anything, you know, well, what do you think about the Indian politics? You know, what about the French language? Why did you select French language? Or you know, what do you think about languages in general? Why should we preserve our mother tongue? Why should you continue speaking in your mother tongue? Or why should you not lose your native languages or your own languages? And blah blah blah. It can be anything.
Okay, basically they focus more on your spoken part than on your writing part, you know, grammatical things. And a language has four aspects, so they, you know, evaluate you on those four aspects of a language, which are very much important. Okay, that's great. And what, suppose if somebody is going for the interview, so what tips you would like to give to that particular person?
Look, I'll tell you what, you know, firstly, be very natural, because what happens to us, you know, when we think of interviews, we get scared. Now, you know, right. You should not think that the people who are taking your interview, they're actually there to judge you. No, don't think that way. Because if you think that way, you know, that will actually stress you. So rather, you can take it, you know, you can take it in a positive way. You can, you know, you can, I mean, you can tell yourself something like, okay, I mean, I need a job, but you know, they need a candidate too. So if I have skills, you know, if I'm fit for that job, obviously I'll get selected. And you should have that positivity in yourself. You know, you must tell yourself, okay, no, it's not a big deal to crack an interview. You just have to speak, you know, feel comfortable and understand, you know, you're actually going to interact and the people are going to ask you questions actually big. So, you know, and then in the end of the day, if you're wrong on something or if you make some small mistakes, well, they'll understand. But then it's just like, you know, you have to give your 100%. I mean, you have to be confident while you're speaking and be confident. Right. You know, that's the key actually.
Exactly. The first thing which you should have is confidence, right?
Exactly.
You should have confidence before going. A lot of people have, you know, they get nervous before the interview. So the
that's
first
right.
thing is confidence.
Yes, and that's right.
Okay, the next question is, why did you choose French language only among so many languages?
Well, I'll tell you what. In fact, the question is, you know, why did I choose language itself? Now, I'll tell you what. When I was in school, you know, ever since my school days, I was very good in languages. And I used to always score the highest in English. You know, I used to score good marks in Hindi. I used to also score, you know, pretty good in Marathi, although I used to find Marathi a bit difficult despite being my own mother tongue. But then, yes, you know, I was always good in languages. And when I was in secondary high school, well, I actually wanted to learn Sanskrit. But my seniors, you know, they dissuaded me from taking Sanskrit, stating that, you know, it's a very difficult language and blah, blah, blah. But then I always had that. I always had a craving for languages. So when I went to college, I was actually doing the research. I used to keep on doing research. You know, what language should I learn? I want to learn a language. So I used to think of Chinese. I used to think of Russian. I used to think of Hebrew, Arabic, French, Spanish, and blah blah blah. But I was confused for a pretty long time. And then I learned. I actually read it on the internet that time that, you know, French is a very beautiful language, and it's a language that's known for, very known for its literature, and it's a language of amour, it's a language of love, and, you know, all those facts, you know, that actually attracted me to French. And that's where I decided, okay, if I'm going to learn any language, that's going to be French. And that's how it started.
Okay, that's great. And what do you think that what career opportunities are there after learning a foreign language in our country, in India?
So right, but you know, personally, when I started learning a language, it was just for hobby. You know, I wanted to learn language, and it was just for myself. But then later on, I realized that, you know, in fact, if you learn a language, you have a variety of career. I mean, you have a variety of options that you can, you know, that you can make your career out of. So especially for, you know, for language, for foreign language speakers, well, you have many opportunities. You can work in the embassies. You can work in the tourism sector. You can work in the teaching sector. And these days, obviously, you have these BPOs and call centers that are actually looking for language specialists, because, you know, they are also into resolving the language barrier issue. So you have many, many, many opportunities in the language field.
Okay, that's great. And how one can become, suppose if someone wants to become a translator or an interpreter, so how that person can become a translator or an interpreter in any language?
Now the key, you know, the key to becoming a translator or an interpreter is actually, mastery over two languages. Because obviously, when you talk of, you know, translation and interpretation, it cannot go on its own. It needs another language. You know, you have something that's called the source language and something that's called the target language. So you have to be, you know, you have to be very good in two languages. You know, these days, you know, when you talk of translation, the only thing that we pair other languages with is English. But, you know, interpretation or translation can be in any two languages. It can be in Hindi to, from Hindi to French, or from, you know, Marathi to English, and blah blah blah. So yes, you have to know these two languages very well, and you have to constantly make efforts to stay contact with these two languages. You know, you have to learn, you have to keep on reading, you have to keep on talking, you have to keep on listening, you have to keep on writing. So, you know, these are the things that will help you maintain your level, or, you know, in many cases, obviously, you know, move forward, or, you know, or gain a better level.
Right. I think you have to become a very good reader for this as well, right? You have to become a very good reader.
Obviously, yes, you have to become
before becoming a good translator.
Yeah. Yep. That's right. You have to become a very good reader. You have to become a very good listener. You have to. Exactly. You have to be. Yeah, you have to be a good writer. You have to speak very well. Yep. That's right.
Correct. Okay, that's great. And what was your own language learning experience?
Well, you know, it was excellent, because I'll tell you what, you know, my language teacher, she had a very good approach. You know, you won't believe, I mean, I started learning language, French language, when I was in, you know, when I was in, I think 13th, yeah, 13th, you know, FYBCOM. Now, when we used to go in the class, I mean, my teacher, despite the fact that we didn't know a single word of French, but she used to actually talk to us in French. And not just that, but she used to talk to everyone in French, even animals. Because, you know, I mean, I started my language learning course at the university. And because I know I already had my college, so I couldn't actually, you know, spend 2 hours every day in a private institute. So at the university, you have the liberty of, you know, of either, you know, skipping a class, or, you know, you can, I mean, these are, anyway, you know, alternatives that you have. So these are like part-time courses. Now, my teacher, she used to speak in French, even with stray dogs. I mean, that's, it's not something that you have to laugh at, but then that shows how passionate the
exactly
self was. Yes, that's right.
Right.
And also, I always had that impression. Oh my goodness! You know, my teacher, she's actually excellent. I mean, she doesn't leave any opportunity where she can get to speak in French. I mean, she speaks French to almost, you know, everyone and everything. So the language experience was very good. And, you know, I had people of my, I had people of all ages, and, you know, I was mostly with you know, with my best friend, my school friend, and you know, we used to have a lot of fun. You know, we used to actually, I mean, obviously at that age, you know, we used to actually make fun of almost everything. I mean, be it vocabulary wise, be it teacher, be it, you know, our fellow classmates, everything. So that was actually a very memorable moment for us. A very memorable moment for us.
Okay, and what tips you would like to people who are going to learn a new language?
Well, firstly, I'll tell you what. What happens in a language class is that you know, there is a high rate of dropout. Now, I'll give my own example. And in the beginning, in the first year, we had about 130 students. Okay, and by the end of the academic year, we had hardly, you know, 5 to 8 students, and there were only five people who actually, you know, were actually there to pass the exam. So, you know, firstly, you have to be determined. You know, you have to do, right. The very first thing, in fact, is to choose the right language, because, you know, there are languages that are a bit more difficult than the others. Like if you say,
right.
Yeah, I mean, Chinese, for
like
example,
Chinese language, right?
Exactly. It's a very beautiful language, obviously, but then, no, it's quite difficult, because
quite
there
difficult.
There are thousands of characters that you have to, you know, that you have to memorize. Had you started learning a language at a very young age, but the only thing you had is to just study, well, you could have taken any language, you know, to study or to learn. But, you know, at an age where you're working, or, you know, at an age where you have, you know, college studies and all those stuff, you can't actually afford, I mean, this is what I'd say personally, you can't actually afford a language which requires a huge investment. So you can perhaps think of, you know, learning an easy language. Like, personally, I feel that Spanish is very easy, and so is Italian. Although French is not, you know, neither very difficult, neither very, very easy. But then, yes, you can go for French as well. And so, you know, once you have chosen a language, you also have to think of, you know, of other stuff, like, you know, other good institutes in your area. Or is this language, you know, actually spoken in the country where you live. Now, in India, for example, we have schools and colleges encouraging students to opt for German or French. So, in our country, we can obviously think of learning French and German, without any hesitation, because we know, and once we have achieved a level, well, we'll get people with whom we can speak in French or German. Obviously, with mondialisation, which is actually globalization, you don't actually find difficulty in finding contacts. I mean, you can find contacts from any corner of the world. You can have a good interaction with them. But then you have to think of that. And the other tips that I give is be very fidgety. Fidgety is you have to be a bit stubborn. And you have to push yourself to learn that language. You have to at least keep a couple of hours on a daily basis, on a very regular basis, to study that language, to learn that language. Because unless you do that, you won't feel encouraged from the inside to learn it. Now, what happens, in the beginning stage is when you actually give a gap. That's where you get discouraged. You say, "Oh my goodness! It's been so long. I've not touched the book. I don't suppose I'm actually going to be able to learn everything now. So it's better. I'll take admission again next year, or perhaps it's okay, and I'll leave it then." And then that should not be your attitude. You have to be a bit stubborn there, and find things that can help you. Try to watch videos in that language since the beginning itself, because you'll get a hang of the accent, you'll get a hang of the way they speak and all those stuff. So you can even try to read, speak in that language with your classmates. That's what I used to do. In the first year itself, when we still learn French, when we had hardly acquired the basic level, I used to actually try speaking in French. My French there was very broken. I used to say something like, "Okay, je veux un verre de water." I mean, that time I didn't even know the word for water, for example. But then I used to actually try. I used to just invent some words in the beginning, and then when I used to get back home, I used to actually look into the dictionary. What's the word for water? Okay, it's, all right, je veux un verre d'eau. So that's how you keep on learning, and you have to be passionate about it.
Exactly the same thing I tell people. If anyone asks me okay, how should I start? So the first thing which I tell them is you need to be committed. You have to be committed first, right? You should be committed first, and you have to be consistent.
Yeah,
the same thing, right. Like you said, a lot of people join anywhere, and they at the end of the course, a lot of people leave in between, right? It is applicable in all the field. Actually, it is applicable in all the field. So many people join anything and they leave in between. And what is the reason behind it? First of all, lack of commitment. They are not committed. They are not serious. And the second thing, which you said, that they have to keep learning something. They should not, keep a gap. A lot of people do this. Now we are going to study after one month and 2 months. That's how, at that point of time, they have to think, no. If I started something, that means I'm going to end it. I'm going to finish it. Right? Yeah.
I've seen all your videos. Yes, they're very encouraging, and that's the kind of tips that we need. That's the kind of guidance that we need from our teachers, from the institute, and from our surrounding. You're right there. Yeah.
I always tell people that if you're starting something, then you have to give some time to yourself. You have to give. If you are learning a new language, then you have to give at least minimum 1.5 years. You have to give. That is the minimum time you have to give to yourself, right? Because it takes time to learn a language.
Obviously, you have to be patient. Yep.
You should be patient enough. Okay, the last question to you is, a lot of people ask me that, what are the career opportunities in abroad? If we know a language, suppose if we know a foreign language, suppose if we know French, so what are the career opportunities for us in abroad?
Look, basically the career opportunities for language learners or foreign language speakers remain the same abroad as in India, in our own country. But I'll tell you what, if you are an engineer, the fact that their language, the fact that you know a foreign language can help you a lot. That is something that can give you an easy promotion, because you have right. of other people. So in fact, you know, the career opportunities can be many, because in India at least, you know, I'd say that you're not that much aware when it comes to foreign languages. But then abroad, obviously people are aware of, you know, of the benefits of being able to speak an extra language. So you know, there are language specialists that are required in almost every field. Like for example, in a hospital, you know, countries like the UK or the United Nations, the United States, France, Germany. You know, these are countries that are also known for what we call medical tourism. So that's where, you know, where you have hospitals that have, you know, patients from foreign countries, and that's where, you know, your services might be required. You know, if you're a doctor and if you speak say French while you're in Paris or in France, well, obviously, you know, you'll be more popular, so to say, you know, than the other doctors. Or you might get a better package just because you know that language. So yes, I mean, if you know a foreign language and if you're actually trying to settle down in that country, you know, that language country, well, obviously it's going to give you a huge advantage. Yep.
And nowadays, actually, people usually want to go to, you know, Canada. And if you know French language, it is going to give you a lot of benefit if you are going to immigrate to Canada, because it is the second official language in Canada, right? French.
Yes, yep.
Right?
Yep, so, that's okay. Right, yeah.
Yeah. So that's all in this session. Thank you so much, Sunil, once again for being on this show, for being on this episode. Thank you so much. It is going to help a lot to all the viewers who are watching us right now.
Well, thank you very much. Yep. Your tips are, you know, the way your institute is actually, you know, conducting trainings and classes, it's already good help. You know, it's a great help to your students. So yes, thank you once again for taking out time and, you know, for inviting me in for this discussion. Thank you.
My pleasure, sir.